And the next talk is by Marc García, and he will talk about understanding random forests. So please, an applause to Marc.
Just let me fix the... I always have problems with the remotes. It was working a second ago. Now, okay. So good morning, everyone. I'm here to talk to you about random forest. This is an introductory talk. I don't know how many of you already know about decision trees and random forest. I would like to know how many of you would be able to, for example, implement a simple version of a decision tree. Like, okay, quite a lot. Okay, maybe for those who raised your hand, probably the first part of the talk would be too basic. For the rest, I hope you can raise your hand next time you get to this same question. Okay. So let's start. Just a note about myself. I've been working in Python for around 10 years now. I've been working mostly in web development for the 5-6 years of this time. And I've been working on Python also and data mining, data analysis, data machine learning, all this stuff for the last 4 years. Okay, those are just random logos of companies I work for, projects I've been involved in. I'm currently based in London working for Bank of America. Not really able to disclose anything about the bank, so don't expect to make the money Bank of America is making by following what I say in this talk. It's really not related. Okay, so this is what I'm gonna talk about. As I said, the first part would be about decision trees, about the CART algorithm. It's not really possible to understand what's a random forest, what a random forest does, or how it works without understanding decision trees, because it's like 90% of it, to say. We'll see, well, I set a practical example. Actually, it's practical, everything is practical in this talk, except a small part of theory and algorithms. But yeah, there is a practical example to more focus for seeing why we need this random forest and how to do that. We'll see how to train random forest, how the whole algorithm work, and we also will see the parameters of random forest. This is probably one of the models with less parameters, if we don't count the ones with the ones that are in CART. And we'll see how this affects, how just to get some ideas. So let's start by how decision trees work. Okay, as I said, most of the talk will be practical. We'll start with a really small data set. It's an event prediction. We have just a data set with three columns. Two of them are telling the age and the of the people who is expected to attend a certain event, and also the distance from the place this person is coming to the event, to the location of the event. And we want to know whether they are gonna come or not. I think PyData is not really a good example for this. I think nobody would miss this, but imagine some other event. So this is the distance. In case I came from London, so I would be in this side. People living in the center of Madrid would be just next to this side of this axis. And this is just the age. Old people, like young people. If this is really our data set, actually I don't think anyone should be using machine learning, and if you still want to use machine learning, I think it's quite clear that a linear model that traces a line just around this would be what we really want. But I think the example is still useful to see how decision trees work. So what a decision tree would do with this example? So I said a linear model would just separate the two points for the best place, and that would be it. And a decision tree, what it's doing is just considering one variable at a time. So it will consider distance first, to say, and age second, and for each of the variables independently, we'll start to find a good splitting point. A good split is the split that tries to give one of the all the samples of one class in one site and all the samples of the other class in the other site. That's exactly what we want. At the end, the best split is the one that gives two pure splits. A pure split is whether we have one class in one site and another class in the other site. That would be like the best case. So let's see it in practice. That's a real tree for this data. So the first split is just separating this. It's quite clear that in this site, people is most likely to attend. So people living just around the corner of the event is probably coming. This guy didn't come, but for any reason. And in this site, people is less likely to come, people in the long distance. That's more or less what we would expect. And the next time the card processes these splits, basically processes them independently. So it's checking both sides, and for both sides it looks for the best split. Again, for both variables or any number of variables we have, and both independently. So in this case, it could still have another division here if it was the case, or in this case it decided just to split them here. So CART is kind of a recursive algorithm. It's not really that an implementation is having a recursive algorithm for performance, but is like the general idea of how they work. So it would keep on for each of the divisions. In this case, we already see that this split over here, this area, this what in a CART would be a node, even if in this representation it's not clear that this is like a node in the CART. This is already pure, so the CART already has stopped and it won't consider this one anymore. So it will go on and go on and go on. And now all the splits we have, all the nodes are pure, so the CART would stop. Okay, this is, as you can see, this is not really, this is a clear overfitting, is what CARTs do. They have some parameters to control the overfitting. We won't see them because random forest control the overfitting, even if the CARTs that make the model are clearly overfitting, random forest themselves avoid it as the ensemble. So yeah, in this case, you can see how this is like, really, really bad model. Now we'll see that these are two alternative representations. Basically, this exact same thing, you can represent it with the traditional form of a card that did a node. Basically, we saw the first split we saw was on the distance, like 2,200 meters to one side, the more than that to the other, and it keeps on splitting until all the nodes are pure. Of course, on a prediction I didn't mention, but if you have a new sample you want to predict it falls in this area, you will say this guy is not coming. If it's in this area, you say, yeah, he's definitely coming. This is another representation. This is the Python representation. It's not how an implementation would work, but if we have a decision tree, and decision trees, in my experience, are not that big, so it could be possible just to get this chart. This is scikit-learn. Scikit-learn gives this to you in GraphViz format. So you can just print and you can just go and implement it. I don't think really many people would do that, but if you really care on performance, I guess this is faster than any other implementation. So what the algorithm does? So the first thing it does is takes the data and looks for the best split. That's the tricky part of this part of the algorithm. Just wanted to put the whole algorithm. Here what it's doing is just like dividing the split, which is the best split that we will see in a minute. It checks whether it's a pure node, so all the classes, y is the class. If the unique value of the class or the number of classes is equal than one, it still go on training. This is a recursive function, so it's keep on working on this same algorithm, looking for a next best split. If it's a pure node, it means that already got just one class on this node, it stops. So that's the algorithm. So as you can see, this part is quite simple. The only tricky part is the only complex part to say is the get best split. So let's see how we get a best split. As I said, we consider one variable at a time. So now we start considering age. We would repeat the same for the second variable, which is the distance. Okay, we sort the, it's important here, they are sorted, so we sort them, all the values of the age in this case, and we see their classes. Okay, we start splitting on the first possible point, so one sample in one side, all the rest in the others, and we simply count how many elements of this class are. Here, for simplicity, I just have two classes. Actually, one of the nice things of cards is that they manage well more than one class, more than two classes, so we could have more here, just for simplicity that I have to. So in this case, the split on the left, there is false is the ones who didn't attend. So it's like just one guy who didn't attend on the left, who didn't attend on the left, and zero people at this point that did attend. So we are just counting them. So then we consider the next split, and we just keep track on the number of classes on each of the splits. Okay, this is the same as I explained in the Python version. We iterate over the features. For each feature, we iterate of the values. The fact that we iterate of the values is just to make it, I mean, we could just consider all the from 18 to 19, 19 to 20, but because there is no 20, any split from 19 to 20 or 20 to 21 would be the same. So it's just for performance reasons. So we consider for each value, and as I said, A and B is the number of elements on each of the classes. So we just compute a metric named the entropy. There are some other metrics. Entropy is the classical one from the original papers. Gini, I think, is the default. It's really similar. And it's the one by default in scikit-learn. So we compute this entropy for one of the sides, then for the other side of the split. We also compute the weight. So we weight them, so we compute a weighted mean of the entropy, to say. This is just because we want to weight them because this split is quite bad. Of course, this is pure, so this would get a really low entropy. That is what we want. It's a pure example, but this one is better. So this is the reason we weight. So we want to just give more importance to this split being poor. If both of them are pure, but one has more samples than the other. So again, I think if you are following, this is quite simple algorithm. There is no magic, not that machine learning stuff. The only missing part that has not been defined is the entropy. So let's see what's the entropy. Entropy, as I said, for computing the entropy, we just need the number of samples on each of the classes. With them, we get the probability. So it's like, we have like five samples. We have two on one class, three on the other. So we get these probabilities, the probability of attending in this case and the probability of not attending, which is the opposite. In one case would be 2/5 and the other 3/5. We compute the logarithms. Well, there is an assumption made here that is basically log of zero, that it's undefined multiplied by zero is zero. And then the important part in here is that if we're in one of the sides of this chart, basically we are in a pure node, and we get a zero entropy, that it's like the best we can get. This in the middle means that we have our split have the same samples of one class in one side, the same samples in the other side. This is the worst case. We're not getting any more predictive power, but just saying, okay, I split my data here, and both of the splits still have the same, how to say, like noise. I'm not really discriminating anything. So we have this shape. Basically, we are trying to get optimizing, getting in one of the sites, so trying to get the best split for pure nodes. Okay. This is the formula, really nothing really tricky, and that's it. That's the whole implementation of a card. Okay, there is just a concept to mention. Cards have this whole entropy thing has a nice thing. When we're training a card, when we are just iterating and going down to every node, we can compute what it's called the information gain. That it's the amount of entropy, we are losing at each step. It's like we want like lower entropies every time, so we want to see how much we're improving. This is good because if we've seen cars tend to overfit, they are constantly overfitting. If we let them, they will classify each sample on each node, or at least until it's pure. As we saw in the beginning, it was one node that it had just one sample, which is not really, really good in many cases. In this case, we can see how we can get really significant splits. We can say at some point, it's like if the information gain is smaller than certain amount, we don't really want to keep on splitting. There are other ways. We will see them a little bit. So let's go with a practical example. Another one to say, this one a little bit more in detail. This is Etsy. This is a website. You can think of it kind of an Amazon marketplace. It's for craft makers. Imagine that you are freelancing, you are living somewhere, and you are making just these fancy pens. And you want to sell them on the internet, okay, you just create your e-commerce inside Etsy, just focusing on craft products. So someone just did a scraping of the website. They give interesting information, like the feedback. It's the number of reviews one of the sellers got. The age, so the how old is a shop when it was set up. Also, the admirers is like the likes, people is liking it. And the number of items, the number of products a given seller has. And we want to predict the number of sales. We want to see who is really successful and selling more. The sales in number, it's not the money, this information is not disclosed. This data set is an old data set. I think they probably have more sellers at the moment, but it just to have like 60,000, it's obtained from this site. Whoever did the scrapping just shared it here. So just to have an idea, this is kind of a specific problem because most of the variables follow power law distributions. Like the feedback is like, there is most of the people don't really have so many reviews, and there are like really few people having thousands of reviews. Same for admirers. Same for the number of items. Most of the sellers have few items, like probably less than 10 or 10. And few of them are really big sellers. They are, actually, I'm not sure if you have 5,000 different products if you are really doing craft products, but that's not the business. This one actually is not a power law, even it has a peak here. It's just like the trend. This is like the age, so it's like the number of sellers they had at a certain point. It's like useful to remember that most of the variables are a power law because I think this is really affecting. Also, the sales, the variable that we are predicting is following a power law. We see that the variables are quite correlated with the sales. And mostly the feedback. That's actually something tricky because I guess you can only put a review of a certain product after buying it, so the correlation is quite strong for this reason. So the case of predicting if we know the reviews, actually it's quite easy. We can see also the correlation here, just some information. So I trained a decision tree. This is not still a random forest. I'm trying a decision tree just to illustrate why we need random forests. Okay, I'll zoom. I'm sorry, I don't have Prezi or something fancy to make the zooms, but we can see in the top node, as I said, the feedback as we saw, as our common sense say and what we saw in the exploratory analysis, the feedback is the most important feature, is what Cart also thinks. And it says like, okay, the first thing I want to do is divide the sellers between the ones that have less than 26,000 reviews and the ones that have more. Okay, then it starts to consider in this site that like the ones with less reviews, like the worst reviewed, well, the less reviewed, not the worst. And it again considers that the most important variable is the feedback. I'll now zoom to the left just to follow here. And we see that again, we are our card for this specific split, the number of selling, is still considering that the feedback is still the most discriminant variable. Again here, and at the end, we have a pure node. Well, and in this case, it's a regression, but I just prune, so it's not really a pure node, and it gets the mean. And the mean for these people, for sellers with less than 207 reviews, basically it says that the estimated is to have this number over here. Okay. What's the first problem that a decision tree have in this case? It's like, as we've seen, we are just using one variable. The others were quite correlated, and we are not using them at all. This is something that at some point you say, okay, I don't know, there is something wrong with my model, and probably if you tell your boss, he's not gonna pay a data scientist salary for just saying, okay, just divide, check the number of reviews and give me the mean of the ones who got less than 207. That's not really machine learning. Another thing that it's interesting to see is that, okay, if I have 207 reviews, okay, my expected number of sales is 108, but then I got an extra review, I compute it again, what's going on? It's like I got an expected value of almost 1,000, so just getting one more review, my model is telling me that I'll get like 10 times the number of sales. It's something that again doesn't make a lot of sense. There is something wrong in this model, obviously. We'll see this is the other side of the tree. In this case, we see in some cases the number of items are considered, not everywhere happens, but in this case, there is a place where we're just making an estimate based on a single sample. So it's like, okay, it was one seller who got a specific feedback, an interval of feedbacks between two values and less than whatever number of admirers. So because of this guy got this specific number of sales, I'm predicting exactly the same thing. Like, okay, but this guy's got less reviews. In theory, it should have less sales, but it got more. It's like, again, it's something that it's, well, it's just a clear case of overfitting. It's obviously not a good model in this sense also. So how can we make this? There are different ways. The first thing, there are some of the problems, like especially the overfitting, decision trees have more than one variable to control it. Usually, the most used, I think, is the mean samples leaf, so you would require that any leaf has at least a minimal number of samples, so you avoid things like this. But still, we can do better than this. Okay, this is just what I said, so it was printed on the slides. So we got a decision tree. It's somehow a cool model, but it still can have some problems in specific cases. It's not always the case. I have decision trees. I've been using decision trees for digital advertising and with really nice results. It's not that you can tune your parameters, you can get good things. This is a specific data that performs in a way that it's quite good to illustrate why need random forest or why random forest improve them. It's not that. I mean, I don't want you to have a takeaway saying that, okay, decision trees are really bad models, because that's not really the case. It's just this for this data and for these parameters, I thought that it was like working at the fourth level of depth. So I'll explain now why we want random forests. Before I address the specific problems on this decision tree, let me explain with an example. I don't know whether you like it or not, but I see ensembles, not just random forests, but I see ensembles as what's the board of directors in a company. If you're familiar, like the board of directors is the group of people who takes the important decisions and defines the strategy in any big company. Okay, and even companies that had like talented people like Steve Jobs to say, and it's like, okay, everybody loves him. And well, not me personally, but most of the people love him. I think we have to recognize his talent, but still, Apple got a board of directors. It is why. Why do we want a group of people when we can have the smartest? So the thing is that if we consider different opinions, different point of views, usually our opinion gets better, gets stronger. So if we take the, like to say, the smartest person in this area and ask him to solve a problem, or we take the whole of us, I would expect like the whole of us at some point gets with a better decision because we have different feedback, different point of views. So it's more or less what's happening. I mean, it's what big companies think. It's why they have board of directors with usually 12 people, at least. And why ensembles usually perform better. I think any competition is usually, of course, they have the problem of performance, but if you don't care on that, usually the best accuracy is in ensembles in many cases. So what's the thing? We have a decision tree, we optimized it. Now we want to have many decision trees, but we already optimized it, so we got the best we could. So how we can still get optimized trees, but at the same time, they are different. The only way to do that is randomizing. We need to choose at some point different things, and the main things that are used for randomizing the trees in a random forest are first randomize the samples. There is this technique that probably some of you know. It's named bagging. We'll see it in a second. Also randomize the features that are used in every tree. We are gonna train multiple trees and we want to use different features for each of the trees, or at least have subsamples of the features in some of the cases. And then we also can, we'll see this in a second, the splits. We were checking, as we've seen before, all the possible splits on our data. We can consider just checking some of the splits. So what's bagging? This is the same data set as before, but in this case, I applied this technique bagging that what it does is sampling, so it will just get a sample of the value, so it won't get the whole data set, and it will do it with replacement. So if you can see that, I think it's not really clear here. Well, maybe here you see the tone of this, like this red is stronger than this is lighter. Okay, this is because this one got selected more than once. That's the whole thing. So those are decision trees trained on these different bagging sampling. So in this case, for example, we sampled something that it just can be split in two. So the easiest and best possible split in this case was just to split on here. In this case, we saw before this looked like an odd layer. This was unlucky because it got the odd layer on it. So actually it's somehow getting a similar split as this one, maybe a little bit lower. And it's getting another split that it's probably not really good. But well, I just did the bagging sampling and I get in the slides whatever I got. So there is no bias here from my side. We got, this one is quite nice because as we saw, our best model looked to be something like this. So in this case, it's like, yeah, older people come more to the events, people who live closer, and these ones are the ones less likely to come. And this one is, again, doing tricky things because there are two that doesn't really are able to split in a easy way. So none of them, maybe those two look better. None of them is probably perfect, but the thing is that we are getting much better results when we just average over them. At some point, if we think on that, in all the cases, everybody who is living close will be predicted as it's attending. And in most of the cases, people in this area would be set as they are not coming, people who live far and they are younger. So this is bugging. Bugging is quite good. It's the base of the random forest algorithm, but it's not always good enough, because in the case of the feedback, if I do that, feedback is still the best splitter for all the cases, for all the trees, even with bugging. So there will be many cases on I'm just making all the predictions based on the feedback. But as we saw, the correlation on the other variables was still quite good. So I think it's still useful to have a fine tuning of the results based on some other variables. So we have, this is when I talk about the specific parameters, is like the naming in scikit-learn. That's, I'm not sure if there is any other good implementation. Well, as good as scikit-learn is the one I'm using. The max features is the parameter where we decide how many features we want to consider each time. For regression problems, it's recommended, like empirical experiments recommend to use all them, to not really be using a number, limiting the number of features. And for classification, it's usually the square root in each of the cases, so kind of a small part of the features. Of course, that depends a lot on the data. It's like different data sets will perform better with different parameters. But that's like the best empirical results in general. What I was mentioning before about randomizing splits, we could have all this checking every single split, but we can create we can randomize it over decision trees, over different splits. I don't want to repeat the word, but where we're splitting, we can just add some sort of randomness in here. And at the same time, we can gain on performance, because before we were just trying an split for each sample, unless there are values that are repeated. And if we're just taking a few of them, in this case, there is a better way to, a fastest way to process. It's like not so much time consuming. Scikit-learn by default doesn't use splits if you use the random forest classifier or the random forest regressor. And they provide this extra tree regressor and extra tree classifier where they are implemented. If we go back and think on the board of directors, in case I can make this a little bit more graphic. For me, bugging is like having a board of directors that have different backgrounds to say in different industries. I'm just making a decision about a certain company, whether we want to acquire a company. And I have like three people with good financial background, and the different people has been working with different companies, has been evaluated different companies. That's what bugging would do. Like, okay, you have this guy knows a lot, knows that he was studying Lehman Brothers, and Lehman Brothers was bankrupt at some point. So it's like, okay, this guy's opinion is pretty good, but also there are some banks that are making a lot of money, so I want some other director who has experience and has experience in other banks. So at the end, what I would expect is like the average of their opinions is probably something really, not really biased, something really, really representing the whole universe of companies in this case or of data. If we think about the features, I would say that it's like having a CFO plus a CTO plus a CMO in the board of directors. It's like having different point of views. It's like, okay, I want to acquire this company. From a financial point of view, the company is performing well, but operations is performing bad. In marketing, they are really bad. So it's like getting this information. I think it's really rich. And the kind of the splits, I don't have a good example like that. It's just like telling the directors, okay, just decide how many options do we have and just bin half of them. Not really, really good. So going back, we had a decision tree. It wasn't performing good for our problem. the power loss, the Etsy database. So what happened with that? Okay, we got to a point where we can use all features, because we are making sure that some of the features are not used in some of the trees of the forest. So at some point, if the feedback that it was using is not in one of the, it not get selected in some of the trees, it cannot be considered, the tree doesn't know about it, then it's as easy at some point it will use the other variable, so it will be really getting information. So at some point, all the trees are getting an average. So the average of the trees that doesn't have the feedback will adapt. We expect still that the feedback is the most important, the most determinant variable to classify this, but we will still be fine-tuning with the other variables because we are forcing it. The lack of stability, actually having these average on different trees, what it makes is that our model performs much smoothly. It's like it will never perform as smooth as a linear model that basically it's splitting on the continuous space, and whatever we make a small increase in one variable, the change would be always small. In random forest, that won't be exactly the case. It can be still some bigger jumps, but it would be much smaller than with decision trees. Of course, that would depend on the number of trees. If we go to the extent and we train an infinite number of trees, we'll probably get a really, really smooth model. And regarding overfitting, again, random forest prevent overfitting. That thing we've seen that just this sample is considered. When we average different trees, the chances that just one sample is considered are almost none. Also, random forest, to mention, come with built-in cross-validation, because as we've seen, bugging is not using 100% of the database, it's just sampling our database or a data set. So what we can use is as we train the trees, as we are training the forest, we can use these out of samples, the samples that are not selected by bugging. We can use them to see the out of sample error. So at some point we already, when we finish, we don't even need to do cross validation if we don't want an external one, because random forest will do that for us. So talking about smoothing, this is from scikit-learn documentation. This is a decision tree. This is the, surely you recognize it, this is the Iris dataset, different variables. We can see, for example, in this split here, this is a decision tree, how this is really taking big jumps to say. It's like, okay, from here to here, even if these are closest, there is a point that it changed from one to the other. If we use the random forest, we see how it is smoother, how it's not that clear that this is one class. It's like, okay, I already have different opinions to say. Not the colors represent the confidence you have on predicting a certain class. So here it changes the predictions and it's not as sure. And the extra trees, the most randomized trees, are actually start to having like curvy shapes. It's like they start to make like much smoother predictions. On parameter optimization, as I said, the number of estimators is key. The highest the number, the best, the accuracy and everything, but the poorest the performance. Of course, if we need to train 1 million trees, it will take the time as it would take like one million times the time it would take to train a single card. In this case, this one is just a decision tree. It's like the number of estimators is one. And we can see an interesting property of decision trees. And is that in this area over here, there is a clear overfitting. And at some point it gets to a point that it starts to generalize, and then it will start losing predictive power. When we have the number of samples that it's the same as the number of samples we require on a leaf node, that it's the same as the number of samples, we will just be predicting in a regression case, we'll just be predicting the mean of the whole data set. So it's not really a good prediction, that's what we're losing. And the important property here is we can see how random forest, actually, even if we let them overfit, so we let them to go to the to the extent of, okay, just have one sample if you want it in a leaf node, then still the performance is much improved. There is another data set. One explained that it's just bank marketing. It's from the UCI repository. This is the reference. And here, again, we can see how the cart is improving and then it's worsening when we change this parameter, but random forest actually perform quite well even if we were not tuning this parameter. So, just to conclude, when we should use random forest, I would suggest that using decision trees whether we can, just to get an idea. I think as part of the exploratory analysis is quite useful to train a decision tree and see if it really makes sense, and we can even discover some problems in our data, some things that we didn't see before. Don't use decision trees or even random forest when your problem is clearly linear, as we've seen. A linear problem it will be always better if you have a linear division. They are especially good if we have categorical variables that can be sorted, that they have a specific order. And just a consideration on performance, cards are slower than pure linear models, but and decision trees actually get to train as much cards as the number of estimators we predict. But random forest is, I think training random forest is the one of the first times I've seen Python using more than one core without implementing the multi-threading by myself. So you just have a parameter that's same the number of jobs. And the nice thing is that random forest, even if its cart is lower than a linear model and you have to train more, it's still, they usually compare better. It depends on the problem, of course, and the number of estimators, but compared to super vector machines, deep learning, all neural networks, it usually works well. And just to conclude what we've seen, cart are a simple model. We've seen the whole algorithm in the 15 minutes of the slide. They are quite good to visualize our data. Ensembles are quite good, even if we pay a cost on performance. Random forest fixed some problems from cards, so it's an improvement of the card model. And the main parameters are those. We just need to play a little bit with the number of estimators we want, that we don't want a big number for that, but we've seen how the results start to be quite good, even with a small number. And the mean samples leaf, that it's one of the parameters of the cart, is probably the most important parameter of the cart. And that's it from my side. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Marc. We have a time for two short questions.
Is this data set of the bank example you gave public, or?
Yeah, it's in the UCI, in the University of California, Irvine. Yeah, it's one. There is the reference down here. They actually force you to put that if you use the data set. That's but you're lucky. You will have these slides anyway. Yeah.
Another question? So two things. Wi-Fi. The Wi-Fi network, the one that you can use, is Campus Community, and the password is make it happen all together in lowercase. And about the plugs, if you want to plug the computer in, maybe you have not noticed, but you have plugs below, the ones that you're seated, okay? And just maybe you're hungry or thirsty, coffee break is there, okay? So thank Marc again.